Definitely one, two. There we go. Four times. It's that kind of Sunday, right? All right. Well, good morning and welcome to the Well Church. My name is Marcus. I'm your family life pastor, and we are so very glad that you are here, guys, especially on a nice, cool Sunday, finally. Hey, friends, if you want to get in contact with us at all, if you have an update on your phone number or email address, or if you've never done that, given us your information, you can do that by going to right in front of you. You can go to the communication card. You can fill that out, and you can put it in the foyer, the little box in the foyer. If you're online with us this morning, you can go to thewellyukaipa.com and go to the sermon blog section. Most importantly, on both online and here, if you have any praises or prayer requests, we would love to know about it because we do love praying with you, praying for you. We know that you pray for us as well. We'd love that opportunity as well. You can do that on the bottom of that form. So with that in mind, I'm going to give us just a few announcements of this morning. We have coming up on October 25th, Rock the Block. And this is a family event for just our church community. So young and old, everybody is welcome to come, all of our families. If you come, it's going to be, we're going to be right here on the patio. Please bring a chair, bring your Bible, bring snacks, bring some shade if it's sunny outside. We're just going to have a good time on that day. We are collecting candy for that event. So if you'd like to bring some bagged candy over the next few Sundays, bring it and put it right in the foyer. So I'm going to pass it over to Pastor Ron now for a quick announcement.
Okay. Hey, there it is. It's operator error. All right. If all else fails, turn the switch on. There we go. Well, thanks, Marcus. In your bulletins that you have with you and also on our website is some information about what I'm going to announce next. We are going next June on a trip to Israel together as a church. We have... 15 to 20 slots that are available still. We have about 7 people that have already signed up to go, and that's without any advertising. So inside is a brochure that tells about the dates and the times and the cost. And then in the middle is the registration form. You can do it online, and I would suggest that you do that there as well, too. So check it out. If you have any questions, just shoot me an email. I'd be happy to talk to you about it. I'm going to be leading with a fellow that I've met, and he's a great guy, Dr. John Delancey. And he's going to be, he's taken probably, I think, somewhere around 100 trips to Israel and led about 100 groups. So he really knows what he's talking about. He's a great guy, and he will be the actual person that's leading us through this adventure. So next June is when it's going to happen. We're hoping everything's all open and everything by that time. So the 14th to the 27th of next year. So if you have any questions, just shoot me an email and I'd love to chat with you about that. We can talk about it too. So great. Thank you very much.
Well, I'd invite you to stand with us as we read this month's Bible memory verse. James 1:2-3. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. James 1:2-3.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. So good to be here with you all this morning. We have a great cause for rejoicing this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. God is good. So let's celebrate him this morning. Let's give all of our praise to him. It's the wrong key. Hold on. Okay, there we go.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice, wants to know the affections of the Father, who will never let them go. Sing it out. Rejoice. Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. It's worthy of all praise. Rejoice. Sing the mercies of your King. And with trembling rejoice. All our sins, all our sorrows, Jesus carried on the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice, when you cry to Him, He hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice, sing the mercies of the King, and He will help you sing. Rejoice, and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King. And with trembling rejoice.
Amen.
Take me away. then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Great God we serve, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated, church. Sorry, can we do No Longer Slaves one?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies.
Sing it, church.
From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. No.
He takes all of our fear.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
As we come to this time in our service where we participate in worship of God through our offerings, just want to thank you all for your continued support of what God is doing here, and it's your gifts that make possible us to be able to carry out God's plan for what we're doing. And so thank you all for your continued support. Again, just a reminder, there's three ways you can give. You can give in person here at the well in the offering boxes at the back, or you can give online, or just mail the church a check as well. Those are ways that you can participate in that. So let's pray together as we bless this offering. Father, we do give this offering to you, and we ask that you would take this time just that we could recognize to you exactly what you are, that you are the ruler and the king of all this world. And no matter what turmoil is happening in the world, the politics or wars or anything of those great magnitude, those great things that harass us, but then also the little things of our day-to-day life, Lord, you are the Lord of all of those things. And so by our giving, we recognize that sovereignty that you have in our world. We offer back to you a bit of what you've given to us, and we ask, Father, that you would use these gifts to further your kingdom here on the earth. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
In our lungs, so we pour out.
Church, there's a day coming where all the earth will stand, or more than scripture accurate, we'll kneel before the Father and acknowledge Him, shouting His praise. So would you stand with me this morning? We're going to proclaim this together. One day all the earth will shout His name. Silent Stone.
Father, we come to you now in this time of just setting aside our crazy busy lives, Lord, and turning our hearts towards you. And we ask this morning, Lord, that we would be aware of your presence on this road that we're traveling. Lord, open our eyes, just as you did so long ago, to those who were traveling with you on the road to Emmaus. Lord, we pray that we would see you. Because, Lord, in the middle of this this crazy life that we have, it only makes sense when we see you, and it only has meaning when we have you traveling along beside us. So we ask today, Father, that you would just open our eyes to you. Let us see you at work in our lives and in the situations around us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You know, last week we talked about an invitation to a journey and about God's GPS, how he keeps us on the track as we're following after him. And we talked about this road trip to Emmaus last week. And as we are talking and as we're looking at this invitation to a journey, our life with God is that. It is a journey. It's not something that you come to Christ one time and then all of a sudden you're saved and that's the end of it. You actually begin on this trip with Jesus. And The interesting thing about this trip with Jesus, and I love these pictures that we picked, because that is what it is. It's a joyful, adventurous journey. And a lot of times we just get bogged down and we just think, oh, you know, I have to be this Borg who has assimilated into the culture and be just like everybody else. But the reality is that God has created each of us with a different and distinct personality. And so today we're going to look at this invitation to a journey in light of our personality and the journey. Because each of you are created as an individual. Each of you has a personality that is different than anybody else. There is nobody like you. It's amazing. And you are all the same. And some of you, you know, it's a good thing. My goodness, this world would be crazy if we were all the same. Imagine if the whole world was nothing but a bunch of weird Al Yankovics. It would be really strange. Or if the whole world was nothing but Ben Stein. And you're thinking, who's Ben Stein? He's the guy that kept calling Forrest Bueller's name. Bueller. I think that was his name is Ben Stein. So, you know, we have different personalities for different reasons. And we're all put here for different things on this earth. Some of you are here just to be a warning to others. But the background of this trip that these guys were on is they were on this journey with all of their different personalities, and they were doing these things they were walking, they had seen the life of Jesus, and then after Jesus was crucified, they began to go on a walk. And last week we looked at Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. And we looked at this long story, how they were walking along and they were so despondent and they were so focused on what was going on in their lives as they were taking this road trip to Emmaus. They were so focused on this that they missed the fact that Jesus was right there with them. And I wonder how much times we're looking around and we're seeing all this stuff going on. There's pandemic and there's crazy political stuff going on, and everything is drawing our attention away from the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is walking right with you through all of this. And this is nothing he hadn't seen before. He has seen societies and cultures and countries rise and fall. And he has walked with his people through all of that. So my friends, I'm here to tell you today, whatever your fear, whatever your political persuasion, whoever wins the political fall-de-rall that's happening in November, Jesus Christ is still on the throne. Jesus Christ is still the one that is going to have his will done, and he is the one that is going to establish his kingdom, and the gates of hell are not going to be able to stand against that. So Jesus walked with these guys, and pretty soon they became cognizant of the fact that after they went and hung out at the place they were going, Jesus broke bread with them, and they realized, oh wow, it's been Jesus all along. And he taught them all how the Old Testament, how it spoke of him. And then they recognized who he was. And so right after that, in Luke 24, starting with verse 36, Jesus just revealed who he was, and it says, well, they were still, you know, and then Jesus disappeared out of there. So that was just, they were just like, whoa, whoa. And they were talking about it. And at verse 36, it says, while they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. You know, he always would say that after he was resurrected. Don't be afraid. Peace be with you. Because what happened is he just appeared in the middle of the room with them. And we read this and we say, oh yeah, Jesus appeared. You know, I'm telling you, that would freak you out. If you saw that, you'd be going, whoa, what is happening here? I'm never going to drink that stuff again. Jesus said, peace be with you. Verse 37, they were startled and frightened. That is the most understated passage in the whole Bible. They were startled and frightened, thinking that they saw a ghost. Oh, saw a ghost. Well, look out, Scooby. You know, I mean, it was like, there's a ghost. And he said to him, why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your mind? And you know he had a smile on his face while he was doing this. Because he was thinking it was kind of funny. Because they were startled and frightened. He said, hey, chill. It's all right. What are you so excited about? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones as you see I have. When he said this, he showed him his hands and his feet. And while they still didn't believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked him, do you have anything to eat? Isn't that the coolest thing ever? Our God, the creator of the universe, appears to people after raising from the dead. And he goes, hey, you got something to eat, man? Isn't that the coolest thing? That we have a God that transcends it all, but yet he comes to us where we are. Hey, man, I could go for some nachos right now. You have anything here to eat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. He looked at it and said, it's not my first choice, but all right. That's not what he said, dude. And he took it and ate it in their presence. So Jesus continued with them, met them where they're at, and wanted to show them that it's really me, man. Look, I'm going to eat. Watch. People always say, is there going to be food in heaven? Yes. It will be zero calorie and it will taste good. Praise God. You can't have both of those things on earth. All right? But he appeared to this diverse group. Now, look around in this room right now and look around at the people that you're out there sitting on the couch in your PJs watching this. And listen, I'm telling you, it's a diverse group. I'm looking at you guys, and yes, you are diverse. You are different from one another in here. All right? You are. You're very different, right? Look at the person next to you. Are they different? Yep, different than you are, right? Different. And we're all different. And that's a very good thing. Now, the New Testament is replete with stories of ordinary people that God is using in an extraordinary way. I want you to know that all the heroes of the Bible, all the people that you read about, they're just folks. They just got up in the morning and ate breakfast. They had arguments with their spouses. They were just normal people. We have a tendency of putting people in a Bible on this great big pedestal. But here's all these people that are amazed and not even believing that Jesus was in their midst. I was reading through some parts of the New Testament today, and there was examples that I saw of six kinds of Christians, just that I just took out kind of at random this week through the New Testament. First, there was Peter. Peter was an adventurer, right? Peter was the adventurer. He was the guy, ready, fire, aim guy. They came to arrest Jesus. Peter busts out a sword and chops off the guy's ear. Now, he was not aiming for his ear. All right? Jesus was, or Peter was aiming for the guy's noggin. The guy ducked, lopped off his ear. Jesus put it back on and said, Peter, come on. Put away your sword. It's not the time for that. So there's Peter, and he was an adventurer. He was the guy, remember, that walked on the water to go out and see Jesus? I mean, we tend to say, oh, he looked at the waves and kind of sunk down, but he was the only one that got out of the boat. Some of y'all just been sitting in the boat the whole time, criticizing Peter, because he's doing something. There's one guarantee. If you plan to do something for God, I want to promise you that one thing will be the outcome of it. Somebody's not going to like it. And it's just okay. Right? I've told you before, someone once said they didn't like the way that I prayed. And I said, it's okay, I wasn't talking to you anyway. You know, and so different kinds of people do different kinds of stuff. There's James. There's a few Jameses in the Bible, but this next guy, James, on our list, he was the critical younger brother of Jesus. All right? Now, could you imagine having a big brother that's perfect? Now, we all have had big brothers that thought they were. All right? But, sorry, John and Carl. But we all do that. And yet, James's brother, his big brother, was Jesus. But part of the way through Jesus' ministry, James and a bunch of his brothers with mom came together to grab Jesus and take him away because they thought he was lost. He had lost his mind. He was very critical of his older brother. Different kind of guy. There was John. John was one of the sons of thunder. The other, James, was his brother, and he was a son of thunder. Now, you don't get a nickname like the son of thunder by being Casper Milktoast. All right? This guy was a troublemaker. This guy was, he was a brawler. He was probably a fighter. He was probably the guy that would just like, yeah, let's fight, you know? And it's like he would just find a reason to get into a scrap. And look at these other guys that are Christians in the New Testament. The Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, he had such a great mind. He was a thinker. And he was one of the great minds of the rabbis of the time of Jesus. He was a Pharisee. And he would go around, you know, teaching, and he was well sought after. And he actually was kind of, you know, he was being groomed to become a power broker within the Jewish religion. He was at a high up denominational level. And Paul was this brilliant mind. You can read it through the New Testament. His thinking processes were so good. And there was Barnabas. And Barnabas was called what? The son of what? Encouragement. He was a totally different guy. Barnabas the encourager. You can do it. And then there was Thomas. All right? And you know, you guys know that Thomas was the doubter, but no. You know, everyone wants to say you're a doubting Thomas. I think he might have gotten a bum rap, actually. Because I went back this week and read a lot of things about Thomas in the New Testament. And you know what? I have changed my opinion of the Apostle Thomas. Matthew, Mark, and Luke give us nothing about Thomas. They say not a word about him. Three of the Gospels doesn't even, they mention that he was one of the 12, and that was it. But the Apostle John talks about it in three different ways. It's very interesting. John gives us this insight watching him. In John chapter 11, Jesus was talking to Mary and Martha, and whose brother had, was getting ready to go see Mary and Martha, whose brother passed away. And Jesus said to the disciples following him, he said, Lazarus is dead. Let's go to Jerusalem. Now, they just came out of Jerusalem, and they got run out of town on a rail, and they were getting threatened to be killed. And everyone's like, and they were in, you know, they were going to go from you know, they were close by at Bethany. And for everyone in the disciples, they knew this was a suicide mission, man. We go to Jerusalem, it's over. We're going to be dead. And Thomas said, well, let us go and die too. He was ready to lay down his very life for his King and Lord Jesus. Amazing. And that's doubt. That's a guy that we look to as being doubting Thomas. In John chapter 14, Jesus said, you know, in my Father's house are many dwelling places, and I go to build a place, and where I go, you're going to come too. And Thomas said, and Thomas couldn't bear the thought of being away from Jesus. And he said, if you're going away, we don't even know the way that you're going to go. We want to be with you, Jesus. And Jesus gave those famous words, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," in John 14. And see, Thomas just couldn't even bear the thought of Jesus going somewhere and him not being with Jesus. Now, I read John MacArthur's commentary this week on this, and he suggested a different title. He said, maybe we should call him John the Pessimist. Because he did kind of have, you know, oh, we're going to go die, you know. He's a faithful follower of Jesus who just happened to notice the downside of things. He was kind of like Eeyore in Winnie the Pooh. Oh, bother. And Eeyore, you can say a lot about him, but he was faithful to Pooh. Eeyore was his buddy. And he just, you know, wanted to be with Pooh, but he's like, oh, things are terrible. You know, and that was Eeyore's thing, but it was kind of like, I think maybe doubting Thomas, he should be Thomas the Pessimist, maybe might be a better thought. He was faithful, but just a little bit melancholy. That was more of a good picture, I think, of who he is. But the point of this is we see all of these imperfect personalities that are following after Jesus. Now, who in here is imperfect? Okay, that would be all of us. From here to there, okay? None of us are perfect, all right? But look at all the different personalities that God has collected just in this little room right here. And the question that I want to ask is, which of those personalities is the best? The answer is yes. All the best. Because God is, for some reason, thinking it's cool and great to bring this whole diverse group of people with all these different personalities together to accomplish his goal. God has called all kinds of people to be part of his kingdom. All of you guys are all different. Okay? And we're different in many ways. We have different functions. Okay, that's one thing that we are different in. We have different functions. Yesterday at church we had a funeral, and it was a lovely funeral, and I came here, and my role was to speak at the funeral, and I spoke, and other pastors came and spoke. Brandon's role was to play music, and he did a lovely job. But we had a bunch of unsung heroes that were working and putting together a lovely reception for the people afterwards. And they honored them by serving them. And the service of those hearts was every bit, if not more, important. It spoke to that family more than any words that I would say. And even the songs that Brandon would. Because they saw the heart of a group of people that really loved them in the middle of it. See, we all have these different functions. In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul, that brilliant thinker, in verses 12 to 14, he said, just as a body, though one has many parts, but all of its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body. All of us were baptized in the Spirit of God, sealed into his family when we believed. Whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. So that Spirit of God seals us into this family of God. Verse 14, even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. See, we all have different functions that we perform in the body of Christ to build God's kingdom as it is right now in this world. But not only do we have different functions, we have different callings. What is your calling in your life? You know, your function is going to flow out of your calling. But what is God, not necessarily called you to do, but what has he called you to be? What's your calling? In Romans chapter 12, Paul addresses kind of the same kind of a thing. In verse 3, he said, for by grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to each of you. So don't think more highly than you ought. Don't think more lowly than you ought to. But use sober judgment and see where you fit in to this whole body of Christ. And he continues this theme in verse 4. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. You know you belong to the body of Christ. You're part of it. You belong. Isn't it nice to have a sense of belonging like that? You belong somewhere. If you feel like you're a misfit, who's pushing who away? You belong here. I am so glad. I look at this. I look out here, and I can't see you all who are broadcasting out to, but I can see everybody in this room, and I can say with a clean conscience and a pure heart that all of you belong here. And I'm really glad that every single one of you is here today. Every one of you. This is a place for you. Verse 6, we have different gifts according to the grace given each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. Prophesy is speaking forth the truth of God. People who preach, we're prophets. I'm a prophet of God. It's kind of crazy. I don't know why God would use me. And if I start getting puffed up about it, I remember that he spoke through Balaam's donkey. And then I say, okay, right, I remember that, all right? So, anyways, we could go into that, but we won't. So, it was quite a shock to me, though, when I got saved, and the first thing they said is, don't ever cuss again. And I'm like, okay, I can see why not. And then I go to church, and they start reading the Bible. King James Bible talks about another name for a donkey. It's like, I didn't understand the consequence, the whole, anyways. So, moving along. That's not in the notes, and that won't go in second service. All right, so just as each of us has one body of many members, and these members do not all have the same function, okay? We have different gifts according to grace given us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it's serving, then serve. If it's teaching, then teach. We need some teachers in our children's ministry, by the way. I'm telling you. We're getting close to opening back up our children's ministry. We need some people that have a heart and a passion for youth and that will volunteer to teach. And you need to talk to Laura, our director of children's ministry. And we need some people to be youth sponsors and to be helping out with our youth program and talk to Pastor Isaiah. You know, you guys need to do that. Right? If it's to teach, then teach. If it's to encourage, then give encouragement. And by the way, there is no gift of discouragement in this list. I've heard people say to their pastors, I was not the pastor, but I heard them say to another pastor, my gift is to keep you humble, pastor. And I wanted to say, but I didn't. I wanted to say, well, no, not really. And I wanted to say, my gift is to call you an idiot. And that's my gift. And so I didn't do that, though. I was proud of myself. God was at work, even in my youth. All right? If it's to encourage, then encourage me. If it's giving, then give generously. Some of you are incredibly wealthy, and you have really benefited and helped out the kingdom of God by your giving. Some of you are not wealthy, and you still give. And bless your hearts, your gifts are so important. Every single gift. And we take it very seriously when we spend money at the well. We try not to spend our money frivolously because we realize that we're going to give an account to God. And everything that everyone gives is so important. If it's to lead, then do it diligently. Has God called you to lead? And are you not leading? You're not going to be happy if you don't follow what God is calling you to do. And if it's to show mercy, do it cheerfully. So you see, we have this whole different group of people that have different callings. So we have different functions, we have different callings, we also have different personalities. All of our personalities are actually different. Your personality and my personality are very different. By one measure, the Myers-Briggs personality types, if you measure my personality, it's very likely that there's not one more person in this room with the same personality as me, because I have less than 1% of the personality. If you think that I'm odd, you are correct. When I learned about this in college, I was like, oh, because I felt like a weirdo all my life. And I went to college and they said, you are a weirdo. And I'm like, oh, thank God. I thought it was just me, but it really is just me. Yay. Anyways, and so, I we have these personalities, and we see this evident in people that we spoke of above. All those New Testament characters, they were characters, and they all had their own personalities. Someone that I read called them creation gifts. Your creation gift, God's creation gift in you, is your personality. He has created you to be like you are, and it's a gift. Don't fight against it. Paul, in his writing to the Corinthians and Romans, he emphasized the interdependence of the members to the community of faith. We're all dependent on each other, but we're all different. You know, I look at my staff here, the church staff, and we have Marcus, and there's Marcus. There's Marcus, our family life pastor. We have PJ in the back, our communications pastor. Wave to PJ. Hi, PJ. We have Laura, our director of children's ministry. Brandon, our director of worship here. We have Larry, and we have Isaiah right back at the back. And, you know, most of our, it's funny, our guys are all hanging out at the back. What's up with that? I don't know. They're good Baptists. Call them back row Baptists. You got to come early to get a back row seat, you know. And Yvette, you know, everyone, look at the different group that we have as leaders. It's so great. What a diverse group of people. I love these guys. And God has brought us all together. And then you bring in the elders, and they're all different. And then the deacons, and they're really different. And so we have, I mean, from each other, you know what I mean? They have, okay, all right, you know what I'm saying. All right, so yeah, but everyone in this whole room, all of you are different. And God has brought us together. Each of us are created differently. We have different functions and callings and personalities. And so we're created this way so God can build his kingdom here on the earth. But as we celebrate these gifts, however, we should avoid a one-sided spirituality. We should avoid a one-sided spirituality. Okay, now what's a one-sided spirituality? Well, a one-sided spirituality is saying, this is what my strength is, and I'm staying with that, and I'm going to only focus on those things. But just as we need different personalities and preferences and gifts, we get into trouble when we think everyone should be like us. It's okay to be different, but if you say, I'm different and everyone should be like me. And I hear people say that from time to time. Well, they don't think like I do. Praise Jesus. We excuse our lack of love of others by saying something like, oh, that's just not my gift. Or I just didn't feel led. You know? Sometimes we get led outside of our area of giftedness. How about that? Sometimes you got to do stuff you don't like. My mom, when I was growing up, would say, Ron, and she was so sweet, she would say, Ron, would you like to take out the trash? And I would say, well, actually, no, I'd rather not do that. I wouldn't like to do that at all. And her answer was, do it anyway. Okay. And it was a funny thing we had going on for a good part of my life, years. At least weekly, she would say, would you like to take out the trash? And I would say, no, I would not. And she would say, do it anyways. And I'm okay. And so sometimes we just have to do things that we don't like. And as we avoid this one-sided spirituality, we should embrace a fully orbed spirituality. Fully orbed. Okay, that orbed means well-rounded. You know, I always wanted to be a well-rounded guy, and I've kind of achieved that goal. All right? But our fully orbed spirituality works out a lot of times in our personality and how we approach others in church together. For example, an introvert. An introvert, to be fully orbed, needs to learn the value of investing their lives into others. I'm an introvert, man. I am a full-on introvert. And I, in another life, would be a monk in a monastery. My notebook's saying stuff to me here. So, yes. But for me, I have to learn that to be fully orbed, to be a well-rounded Christian, that I have to get out of my preference area and be into other people's world. Extroverts need to learn to enter into times of solitude to see what God is saying to your soul. Sensors, people who have to have all the data. I got to have data. You know, we're having to make decisions about this COVID-19 thing. And so responsible people say, I'm going to look at the data. And then after you do that, you're like, okay, I'm more confused than ever. Because all we're getting is crazy information from all sides. What do you do? But sensors, see, they need data. But sensors need to learn to go with their gut a little bit. Listen to that still, small voice of God inside of you that's prompting. And to do that, you have to be quiet enough to make that happen. There are people who are thinkers predominantly. And that's what they do. They think. You know, I gotta think this through. I gotta have all the facts, ma'am. There's this other part of you that's called feelings. Barry Manilow sang about that in the 70s. You know, feelings. A thinker might want to start asking, "What are my emotions?" I asked someone once, "What do you feel about that?" And they said, well, I feel like I need to do these things. And it's like, no, you don't. You think you need to do those things. What are you feeling? And that person couldn't get to the point that they were really angry. That's a feeling. Or happy. Sad. Depressed. These are feelings. For some people, it's like, oh, you mean I can have those? Yes. God designed you to have feelings. Now, someone told me feelings are schizophrenic friends at best. And so we don't want to let them guide our lives. But you certainly should know why you're feeling things, because they give you insight into why you're doing what you're doing. And it helps you to think better, actually, by understanding why you're feeling what you're feeling. Some of you are feelings, are feelers. You're like, everything's about feelings. You need to learn to think about your feelings. And you need to ask yourself the question, why am I feeling this way? Because some people just say, oh, I'm going to feel, man. And I'm just going to blah all over you. You know, it's like, why are you feeling that? You need to think about your feelings. And it's not that you can't if you're a feeler. It's just that you need to do it a little sooner. You know, don't let your feelings drag on for 3 weeks, and then, because by that time you forget why you were feeling what you're feeling, and you just got this feeling going around. It's like, man, I'm really hacked off and I have no idea why. Right. I know none of you have ever experienced that. Some of you see the world in terms of black and white. There's right and there's wrong. The switch is on, it's off. I'm a computer programmer. It's a one or a zero. That's the way some people are. There's a word you need to learn. Nuance. Life is pretty nuanced. It's a French word. Nuance. It just means little bits of difference between this thing and this thing. Nuance. You need to see that there is a sliding scale of gray in there somewhere. But some of you have many shades of gray, and that's all that you think in. And you need to remember that there are foundational truths that are objective truths, that doesn't matter what you think about them, it's still the truth. If I hear one poor person say, well, this is my truth. There's truth and there is not truth. And I know that's not a good postmodern thing to say, but there is an objective truth that is defined apart from what our perspective is. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's an objective truth. Doesn't matter what you feel about it. Well, I don't think that's true. Who cares? God is up there saying, well, so? Well, if you don't believe that, that's on you. Bucko, Buckwheat, Buck Rogers, you are not aligned with what the truth is. Okay, so do you see how we have all these different sides to us? And the call for us is to develop not just our strengths, but also to allow God to form our shadow sides, those sides of us that we that are probably our weaker sides, and lead us to growth as a whole person. And this is spiritual formation, which we talked about last week quite a bit. You remember our definition from last week of spiritual formation? It's the process of being formed in the image of Christ for the sake of others. Robert Mulholland gave us that great description of what spiritual formation is. And that process of being formed encourages us to grow in areas that maybe we're not so hot at. Now, so what's the result of the change? Well, I want to look at the changes in five of those people that we looked at earlier. Peter, the adventurer, became the leader of the Jerusalem church, and he spent most of his time there, later went to Rome, and was crucified upside down in Rome. Didn't go too far. Not a great adventurer after that. He stayed steadfast and led the church that God led him to. James was that critical younger brother. He became an encourager of faith and works. You've read the book of James in the New Testament. Count it all joy, brothers and sisters, when you fall into various types of trials, knowing that the testing of your faith will develop perseverance in your life. That's what James became. James became a great advocate of his older brother, the Messiah. He got past his own stuff, and he committed and submitted his life to his older brother, Jesus. And then there was John, the son of thunder. He became John the lover. You look at the writings of John in the New Testament, and man, that guy talks about love, 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 love. John was the man. I love the Gospel of John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are about Jesus' action and his teaching and talking about, you know, the high, heady intellectual stuff. And the whole book of John is about relationships. And by the way, that's all you're going to take to heaven with you. It's relationships. That's it. The rest of it stays here. So you haul on a hearse. Most relational of all the Gospels, John. And then there was Paul. Paul the thinker, he became Paul the encourager. Paul. We kind of skipped ahead, I think. Yep, that's all right. Bonnie, did I forget to put Paul in there? Oh, okay. Oh, sorry. I thought I did. So, anyways. Hey, Paul the thinker became Paul the encourager. If you look at his later writings, man, the book of Timothy, look at 1 and 2 Timothy, man, that is a book that is not a lot of intellectual presuppositions, but it's deep and it's personal, relational vitality between Paul and Timothy. See, what happens is when we get on the road with Jesus, he changes us. And then there's Thomas, the last guy, Thomas the pessimist, became Thomas the martyr. You know, Martin, he said he was willing to go to Jerusalem to die with everybody. He wasn't just spouting off. He became Thomas the martyr. A third mention of Thomas after the resurrection was in the Gospel of John. And John said this in John 20:24. He said, now Thomas, also known as Didymus means the twin, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we've seen the Lord. But he said to him, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe. And a week later, his disciples were in the house again. This is what we kind of read earlier from a different perspective. And this is John's perspective. He said a week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Again, just freaking him out, man. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. That's kind of the message, actually, of today. As we're walking with Jesus and as he's transforming your soul, we need to stop doubting and we need to believe. And look what Thomas said in verse 28. He didn't reach out his hand. He just said, "My Lord and my God." What a tremendous testimony. I love what John MacArthur said about this. He said, Thomas, yes, he was melancholy, he was moody, pessimistic, comfortless, shattered. But when he saw the Lord Jesus Christ, oh my, he gave the greatest testimony ever given. And you know what? That one little statement Thomas gave, the speech that literally destroys every lie that has been told about Jesus not being God that has ever been uttered in the history of man. It is a momentous statement. My God, he said. The isms and schisms and spasms and all the rest come and deny the deity of Christ and are put to silence by Thomas. And MacArthur went out and said, learn a lesson. Jesus wants you to be sure. Surety most frequently comes when you hang around other believers. It doesn't mean that Christ can't come to you in the solitary place, as he does. But more likely, he's going to appear among those who are his own. As we are encouraged by the people of God, we will begin to see God more clearly because he uses your personality to not just change you, but to influence the lives of others. Your church needs you just specifically because of who you are, my friends. MacArthur went on and he said, Thomas, tradition tells us a lot about him. He preached. Some say he went as far as India preaching. One tradition says that he died in a very special way, that they took a spear and rammed it through him. Remember Jesus said, look at where the spear was? Come and put your hand in here. Thomas didn't need to do that, but he said, I'm so much in believing in you that I'm willing to take a spear in my own side for you, Jesus. Because of his faith in Christ, it was a kind of fitting climax for the one who told to reach forth his hand and feel the spear mark in his own Lord. So, listen, here, let's just wrap this up. Ready? Here it is. Being with Jesus on the journey changes us. He takes your personality as it was, and he forms it into something that's better, that capitalizes on the strengths and makes up for some of the weaknesses. And he forms you and changes you. And being with Jesus on this journey changes us. And we're all on the journey, but we all have different personalities and we all have different roles in the midst of this journey together. So here's the main point. You ready? The main point is this. It's a statement and a question. The statement is this, is that God uses each of us uniquely to share the gospel and to build his kingdom. Each of us uniquely used by God. And then there's a question that we're going to end with, this question. How are you using your creation gifts and your process of transformation in the service of God's kingdom? So, what I'd like you to do is I would like you to finish writing and put your stuff away. Okay, go ahead and do that. Because we'll hear that holy rustling. Okay? And just set it down beside you. And I want you just to just bow your heads and close your eyes. And just take a moment. And we're going to be quiet. And we're going to listen for God. And we're going to have the band come up. But I want you to just have a moment of quiet and listen for what God is saying to you right now. And you can pray something like this. Lord Jesus, we are here. We are still in our souls. We are quiet before you. And we ask for you to speak in that still small voice. And Lord, we ask for you to draw us to yourself so that we can become aware of your calling in our life. We ask for you to reveal to us what our function is. And Lord, help us to see clearly our personalities and how it fits in with those things. And we ask, Lord, that you would make it clear to us how we are, as we walk this road, that how we're to use our gifts and callings and personalities. Lord, help us to know how we are to use that for your glory and your kingdom and your people. Speak to our hearts. Speak to our minds. Speak to our soul. And change us on the road. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand together and we'll be dismissed. Just want to thank you all for being here this week, and we'll see you back again next week. God bless you, and we'll see you next week. Let's sing.
Sing this together. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Amen. And serve a great God. God bless you and may God keep you.